week on Vaticano. Come to St. Peter's Square to see Pope Francis bless a life-size statue meant to shed a spotlight on the plight of the homeless around the world. Then sit down with Cardinal Robert Sarah to discuss his new book, Catechism of the Spiritual Life. And follow us for the second episode in our series on artificial intelligence in the faith. This week, we focus on trust and whether or not we should trust machines that can potentially rule over us. Vaticano starts now. Joining Carla Rabezzana for her 90th birthday celebration in Asti, a town in northern Italy, on November the 19th, 2022, was a very special guest from Rome. Pope Francis, whose family roots are in Italy's Piedmont region, traveled to Asti to join in the celebrations for his cousin. The Pope's father, Mario José Bergoglio, lived in the Diocese of Asti before emigrating to Argentina in 1929. The Pontiff's maternal grandparents also emigrated to Argentina from northern Italy. The Holy Father took the occasion of his cousin's birthday to attend the private family celebration and also to celebrate Holy Mass in the Cathedral of Asti on Sunday for the Solemnity of Christ the King. In his homily for the final Sunday of the liturgical year, in the place where his own roots lie, Pope Francis said he wanted to reflect on the roots of our faith. The Holy Father encouraged Catholics to ask themselves whether Jesus, the King of the universe, was also the King of their lives. Christ confronted the hatred of the world, Francis continued, and did not just watch as a spectator.
Brothers, sisters, today our King from the cross looks at us. It is up to us to choose whether to be spectators or involved. Am I a spectator, or do I want to be involved? We see the crises of the present time, the decline of the faith, the lack of participation. What are we to do? Are we content to theorize and criticize? Or do we roll up our sleeves, take life in hand, and pass from the if of excuses to the yes of prayer and service?
Delle scuse al sì della preghiera e del servizio.
On November the 9th, just before the general audience in St. Peter's Square, Pope Francis blessed a new sculpture that highlights the plight of the homeless. Titled Sheltering, it's a life-sized bronze work showing the figure of a homeless man sheltered by a blanket pulled by a dove in flight. The image was unveiled just 4 days before the 6th World Day of the Poor, which was celebrated last Sunday, November the 13th. Sheltering is designed to turn the spotlight on the problem of homelessness in the world. This is an initiative of the Vincentian family, a movement of religious congregations and charitable organizations inspired by the life and work of St. Vincent de Paul. The sculpture is by Canadian artist Timothy Schmaltz, who has an established track record in the field of religious statues worldwide. His work, Angels Unawares, dedicated to migrants and refugees, was installed in St. Peter's Square in September of 2019 and blessed by the Holy Father. Presenting his latest work, Schmaltz said the inspiration came from Isaiah 58, emphasizing how helping people on the margins is a spiritual duty. The blanket carried by a dove, representing the Holy Spirit, is intended to engage people in deep reflection on what to do for those living without a home. It took a year to make, and Schmaltz's intention is to create replicas to be installed around the world. The sculpture, blessed by the Pope, will remain in Rome, although the final location has yet to be determined. The Canadian artist explained that one of his upcoming sculptures will most likely be inspired by the Holy Father's encyclical Laudato Si and reflect a specific reference to the care of creation.
Hello
Hello and welcome to this week's Vaticano Updates, the most important news from the Holy Father and the Vatican. As part of their ad limina visit, the members of the German Bishops' Conference were received by Pope Francis at the Vatican. During the two-hour meeting, the Holy Father spoke with the German bishops about the controversial synodal way in Germany. According to the Holy See, the dicasteries of the Curia also criticized the method, content, and structure of the synodal way. The Congregation of Propaganda Fide, a Vatican department dedicated to the Church's missionary activity, is celebrating its 400-year anniversary. A three-day conference at the Vatican sought to examine the centuries-long history of this department, including its global impact today. As part of a reform by Pope Francis, the Dicastery for Evangelization was combined with the Congregation of Propaganda Fide earlier this year. On Thursday, November 17th, Cardinal Pietro Parolin offered a Mass for Peace in Ukraine in the Basilica of St. Mary Major in Rome. The Vatican Secretary of State said in his homily that there is no situation so compromised that the Spirit of God cannot resurrect. The Mass marked the 30th anniversary of the restoration of diplomatic relations between the Holy See and Ukraine. Pope Francis has expressed his condolences for the victims of a deadly bombing on a busy street in Istanbul that killed 6 people and hospitalized around 80 others. Among the victims were 2 girls, ages 9 and 15. The message published by the Holy See states, His Holiness prays that no act of violence will discourage the efforts of the people by the people of Turkey to build a society based on the values of fraternity, justice, and peace. On December 8th, the Solemnity of the Immaculate Conception of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Pope Francis will pray in front of the Marian Column in Rome's Piazza di Spagna. Every year on December 8th, the Catholic Church celebrates the dogma proclaimed in 1854 that God preserved Mary from original sin at her conception. Thank you for watching this week's Vaticano Updates. Anthony Johnson for EWTN Vaticano.
In a few moments, we'll be back with more on Vaticano. In recent years, there have been many attacks against the seal of the Sacrament of Confession. The apparent cause is the publication of many reports about the number of alleged sexual abuses by clergy. These reports have also instilled in public opinion a fictitious legitimization by civil authorities of intervening in the area of religious liberty, concretely seeking to violate the sacramental seal of confession when this regards sexual abuses. Today, a tragic plague present in every sector of society.
Well, it's the sacramental seal. That is to say, it's called the sacramental seal. The priest is bound to keep a total seal on everything he receives within the sacrament of confession. This is a duty that he has, even when the penitent offers to liberate him from it. The confessor must maintain it. The penitent cannot free him from this seal. It is a duty that the minister has carried out in the name of the Creator, who is the only one who can forgive sins.
The Catechism of the Catholic Church explains that given the delicacy and greatness of this ministry, and the respect due to persons, the Church declares that every priest who hears confessions is bound under very severe penalties to keep absolute secrecy regarding the sins that his penitents have confessed to him. This secret, which admits no exceptions, is called the sacramental seal, because what the penitent has made known to the priest remains sealed by the sacrament.
The violation of the sacramental seal is a canonical penalty, a canonical censure, that leads to excommunication. Effectively, the priest would have to submit himself to whatever unjust penalty so as to protect the seal, something that is his duty before God and his ministry.
The canonical censure is regulated by Canon 1388 of the Code of Canon Law, which establishes that a confessor who directly violates the sacramental seal incurs a late sententiae excommunication reserved to the Apostolic See. One who does so only indirectly is to be punished according to the gravity of the crime. It is important to distinguish three aspects of this relationship between priest and faithful, underscored also in a note from the Apostolic Penitentiary on the 1st of July, 2019. First, one thing is the sacramental seal, that is, that which the priest receives in the sacrament of confession. Second, another thing is the internal extra-sacramental forum, such as spiritual direction. Third, and finally, the information shared under the seal of the secret, under which falls the pontifical secret.
Some months ago, the Pope lifted the pontifical secret from all the issues related to the treatment of the crimes of pedophilia and pederasty. Previously, they were included within the penal cases, the penal processes, and all of these were matters of the pontifical secret. But the Pope has lifted it. What does this mean? That it can be spoken of? No, this just means that this is no longer under the pontifical secret, and that one must inform those individuals who have legitimacy to have access to that information on these matters, but they continue to be preserved.
It is important to insist on the difference between the professional secret and the seal of confession. That seal, as Pope Francis has strongly affirmed, although it is not always understood by the modern mentality, it is indispensable for the sanctity of the sacrament and for the freedom of the conscience of the penitent. Exclusive interview with EWTN, the former prefect of the Congregation for Divine Worship and the Discipline of the Sacraments, Cardinal Robert Sarah, presents his recently published book, In Catechism for the Spiritual Life. The Cardinal reflects on the sacraments as the pillars of Catholic spirituality. He highlights the Eucharist and the liturgy surrounding it as the greatest gift left to us by Jesus. Vatican Bureau Chief Andreas Thonhauser asked him how the Church could better explain this to modern society.
We need to rediscover this as the principal means of grace that Jesus established in his Church. We need to understand the sacrament. They are not social affairs. Baptism, for example, could not be delayed to wait for a family meeting. But parents must haste to baptize the children because the baptism is really the gate to the spiritual life, to a gate to enter in the Church. Each of the seven sacraments are a gift of the Church to illuminate how God intervenes in our lives for the sake of our salvation.
You write about the loss of faith in the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist. Why do you see this as a cause for a decline in the Christian communities? How could we revive this faith?
I know that without faith in the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist, the Church becomes a wholly horizontal phenomenon. The Church loses the meaning of her existence. The Church is not a
social organization to meet problem of migration or poverty. The church is a divine purpose to save the world. If Christ does not dwell within her church, tangibly, visibly, sacramentally, then what good news do we have to offer to the world? What is the meaning of evangelization? When Christians forget why they are Christian, the community must fall into decline.
Maybe for the last question, could you also tell us a little bit how this sacrament, how the Eucharist is challenged today in the West, and also maybe more particularly even in the church itself?
It is great to be baptized because we enter in the life of God. We become children of God. It is great to be a priest because a priest and even a Christian is not only an alter Christus, but he is ipse Christus, is Christ himself. So we have to be very proud to be a Christian, to be priests, and to live the priesthood with sacredness. It is beautiful to be confirmed, to be soldier of Christ, to fight for Christ. It's an honor. It is great to be married. The marriage is a very great sacrament. It is the mystery that celebrates the union with Christ and his church. So if every Christian could live properly his marriage, it is a great sacrament, because we concretize the links between the church and Christ. And this link is perpetual. So what I try to explain in this book is really to discover again and again this great gift we have received from Jesus Christ before leaving our world, to make us capable to live the life of God. That I was like to would like to aid, and I thank you for making known not my ideas, but the idea of the church, because I didn't invent anything. I just transmit the teaching of the church. So thank you for making known my book. I pray for all who is reading this book, and that he make discover the richness of the sacraments.
Thank you so much for taking the time and writing this book.
Thank you indeed.
We'll be back after a short break with more on Vaticano. Intelligence is our most important resource. Most problems in the world have some intelligent solution, if a solution is compatible with the laws of physics. Because of this, major companies and nations are spending an enormous amount of energy and capital doing research on artificial intelligence in order to find out how to maximize accessible intelligence. The fear is that we are collectively racing towards something that we do not fully understand. electronic circuits function a million times faster than biochemical ones. So, hypothetically, a machine could think about a million times faster than the minds that built it. Pope Francis has often called us to use our intelligence, to take the time to reflect and understand the signs of the times. The problem is, what happens if the times we're living in start to become dictated by the invisible value pushes and disappearance of competing points of views, by machines and other intelligent circuit-based entities that do not share our best interests? Given what's at stake, we spoke with Professor Paolo Soda from the Campus Biomedico University of Rome to better understand what future those working on AI see for our collective species.
I understand the perception of risk that many people may have. It is like when there was the first industrial revolution. The advent of machines, like the steam engine, completely changed the ways of production and invented new paradigms. There have been several revolutions, and now we have arrived at the fourth industrial revolution. Here, artificial intelligence is the protagonist of this fourth industrial revolution. I believe that if humans are always at the center of this development, paying attention, we will not run this risk.
It is useful to look at other industrial revolutions to compare what we're going through now with artificial intelligence, but it seems that the very essence of intelligence is being threatened to be outsourced and begs the question, of what value is intellectual work? At the moment, we're in the field of narrow artificial intelligence. But what is narrow artificial intelligence exactly?
Let us say at this time we are in the so-called narrow artificial intelligence. That is, artificial intelligence to solve a very specific problem. But to use the example of smartphones, we use facial recognition techniques or fingerprint recognition to unlock our devices. So this artificial intelligence is not able to solve general problems. We are still in the context of this research. Even when we see applications that are extremely striking to our imagination, such as those by Google or Amazon, they are still applications in a very specific context. The algorithms that are available today are capable of learning specific contexts, albeit with some breadth. Think of speech recognition, natural language processing. We are still in a specific domain. In a decade, we will probably go towards general artificial intelligence, situations where artificial intelligence will be able to harmonize together heterogeneous information from even different domains.
Anche da domini differenti.
And to focus on the big issues, we must have a stable bearing on our humanity and our history. Giacinto Baresi is a researcher in collaboration with the Campus Biomedico in Rome, who focuses on the relationship between the human and the robotic. We spoke to him about the digital era that's already enveloping us, and the coming seductions and predicaments that await us all with the power and hypnotic prowess of future AI systems. How will we as humans orient ourselves in that kind of world?
In many ways, we cannot think of the human being without the history, nor humanity as a whole, not the individual, without the history. This history has a past that needs to be remembered. It has a future that needs to be shaped according to the value that each of us has. So principles that are based on morals that can be different within certain limits, always on respecting the other, and always on making sure that you never do to others what you would not want done to yourself. It becomes a guideline, in fact, not a technical guideline, but a guideline, a principle that should be followed in setting up any of these technologies, because they are action potentials. We actually enter into someone's story, offering these possibilities, however, also trying to understand how these potentials could be used. So, it is as if we are introducing to someone else stories when we make of these machines or these device, the solution, an element that could be unpredictable,
un elemento che potrebbe essere imprevedibile.
Ultimately, our safety and our sanity requires us to return to a better understanding of ourselves. As René Girard says, humanity is a child of religion. There lies our history and our understanding of ourselves.